Let me ask you a question. Is it possible to know the sound of something that you've never heard? I sat on this for a little bit, and I'll be honest, I still don't know the exact answer. Because I was like, okay, I kept thinking of like a bumblebee, and just like hearing that. And I was like, okay, if I've seen it, but I've never heard it, how can I for sure say that that's the sound of a bumblebee if I've never heard it before to match it up to what I've seen? So can what we see always dictate what we've heard, and can we not what we've not heard show us what we've not heard? Okay, sorry, I'm just like twisting up here. Is it possible to know the sound of something that you've never heard, that you've never encountered, that you've never experienced, that you've never taken in? And I was thinking about this thought, and we're stepping into a week. Progression had, I'm hearing a great service last night. I popped on the site, and I heard a little bit of Pastor Steve's message today, and we're going to hit it tonight. Friday is Good Friday. Saturday is the exploration. Sunday, three services of Easter, and we're going after it. It's a week that we celebrate. It's a moment in history that is, it was just a game changer, and it's so important, and it's so specific to who we are. If you call yourself a Christian, a Christ follower, literally this week literally should mark who you are. If this week is not a week to celebrate, if it's not a week to give God praise about, to at least remember, then really we're not, you shouldn't call yourself a Christian. Like, this week defines us. And usually, I don't know, to be honest, I sort of can float through the week and just like, I keep going, just the same old, but this week's just been hitting me different for some reason. There's been a certain sense of thankfulness. There's been a certain sense of God's presence on me. I sat in my office most of today, and I just bawled my eyes out, to be honest, preparing for this message. I'd start writing it. I'd write a point. I'd be like, I love you, Jesus. I did. I mean, I was just like a mess. And it's a certain heaviness, but I was thinking about this. It says in the book of Romans, chapter 10 and verse 14, it says that, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? Is it possible to know the sound of something you've never heard before? Is it possible to believe in something you've never heard before? We're talking about this whole idea of the sound. And I guess what I have to present to you tonight is, it's called the gospel of Jesus Christ. And at me preaching this gospel, you have the opportunity to hear this gospel and believe this gospel. And in that, live out this gospel. But for some of you in the place, maybe if you've never heard a gospel like this, or you've never known God to a certain depth, how should we expect you to believe if you have not yet heard? And so tonight, I guess like my whole goal is that we just can all step into, right now, tonight, hearing God's voice through his word, hearing about who Jesus is, and really take in, and for me, not forget the price that Jesus paid. I've been living for God a long time, so I really easily forget, like, how much he really went through so we could be called followers of him, so we could be forgiven of sins, so we could go to heaven, so we could show up in this place. I forget. I don't think anybody in this room could wake up, say they wake up every day and they're like, oh my gosh, I'm just so thankful for what God has done in me. Like, he died on the cross and I can see him. He's all bloody right now and I couldn't get through the day. You're a liar if you say that. Because you wake up and you're like, crap, I'm running late for school. I'm running late for work. I'm running late for running late. And we get moving and we get pressed and whatever's going on. And we got to remember what Jesus did at this moment of crucifixion, at this moment in history for us. And tonight I want to break it down. I kind of want to lean in. And this is what I want you to do. This might be tough for some of you. How many of y'all you're have visual minds? Raise your hand. Like something said and immediately like you're seeing it. Okay. That's me. That's like a bad thing. I was talking to Mike Sheffer one time, and he was telling me about like people were talking about just like somebody's butt or just something dumb or somebody farting, and he's like, oh, I'm just like seeing it, taking it in. And this is what I want you to do tonight. As I know obviously you're hearing my voice, you're seeing me as well, but when I describe anything, when I read scripture, when I take you somewhere, I want you to try to hear what was happening. Rather than paint a picture with your eyes, I want you to try to hear it. So if I'm talking about Jesus on the cross, I want you to like try to hear his last breaths before he said, "It is finished." I want you to hear the hammer hitting the nails. I want you to hear people yelling. I want you to try to hear it. Sound good? I mean, this is not something we typically do, but I want us to kind of dig in here and try to hear what's happening. The title of my message tonight is The Sound of the Cross. And I want to take us right into the sound of the crucifixion, right into the sound of something that happened over 2,000 years ago. It amazes me today in this generation, but to be honest, in any generation, I prayed as I was writing this sermon, and I don't know if I've ever exactly prayed this before, but I said, "Lord, forgive me for my humanity." Usually I say, like, "Lord, forgive me for this sin or that sin." I said, "Lord, forgive me for my humanity." Because in our human condition, the Bible says that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So simply just by being humans, we've sinned. It wasn't the original intent that God had for us, but simply by being a human being, you've already sinned. And I was like, "Lord, forgive me for my humanity." It's crazy that in our humanity, we are so fickle, we are so moved by emotions. We're high for one thing and we're low for it the next. We come into church one week and man, this Jesus thing is popping. The next week, we're here for the ping pong. And it's really interesting that our whole walk is like this. If you look at the people of this time, if you look at this whole setup, Jesus is coming in. It's called his triumphal entry. People have these palm branches. That was this last Sunday called Palm Sunday. And they're waving them and they're just yelling, "Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to the King of Israel." And they're just like, they're popping, man. Like, "Hosanna, Hosanna." And they're just going, and they're just like, they're pumped. Literally just like a little bit later, they're yelling, "Crucify him, crucify him." They're like, "Give us Barabbas." It's interesting that we can so quickly be so hot for something and then so cold. It's interesting that we can let our emotions and our humanity guide us that much that we can't finally come to the realization, the understanding, really, of who Jesus is and in turn who we are. So this is what I did as I was preparing for this message. I said, "Lord, forgive me for my humanity. Forgive me for my shortcomings. Just by simply being a human being, Lord, let me not be so guided by just what I feel or what I think or just who I am as flesh and blood. But Holy Spirit, come and begin to do such a work in me that you just kind of like, just get me in action. Keep me going. Keep me focused. Not let me get so sidetracked and distracted." Before, there was all these moments of, you know, crucify him and everything going to the crucifixion. You'll see at the very beginning, the first sound that you'll hear in the preparation for Jesus to go to the cross, it's the sound of betrayal. It's the first sound sort of echoed into history that really set up this moment. Jesus was in a place called the Garden of Gethsemane. If you've never heard, if you have, I'm just going to make sure we're on the same page. And right there was the Mount of Olives. Now, this is huge because right where he is in this moment before he's going to die, it's the moment that in the book of Zechariah in the Old Testament, it prophesies that when Jesus comes back, where do you think he's going to land? The Mount of Olives. And he's going to crack it. He's going to split it in half east to the west. And he's going to be like, "I'm back." And he's going to come back. I think that it's such a significant place as this was the place that he prepared to go to death for our sins. So he's here as usual with the disciples. He's praying. He's kind of telling the disciples, "Hey, just for 1 hour, pray. Pray against temptation. Pray against anything that would distract you." Like, basically, he was saying, "Prep yourself. Like, I'm about to go die, guys." But he didn't, like, say it quite like that. Everything he said, they were kind of like, "I don't quite understand what you're saying, Jesus," because it hadn't quite happened yet. And he's there. He's praying. He's in this moment of agony, the Bible describing such agony that he's in. And he prays this prayer to the Father. This just shows his humanity that he had to fight. In the book of Luke chapter 22, he said, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me." Now listen, he wasn't drinking anything at the time, y'all. He's saying, like, could you just let this pass? Can you not make me have to, like, pour out my blood for all mankind? Can you not make me have to die on the cross? Take this cup from me. Yet, I'm struggling, God, help me. Not my will, but yours be done. Now, let me set this up before I read this next part. You'll find that when you're honest with your humanity, you ask God for help in the midst of your humanity. You know what he does? He sends you help. Right when you feel like you can't do it, but you call and you say, "God, come on, let me out of this. I don't want to do this. Yet, even though I don't want to do it, not what I want, what you want." So what does it say happened? An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. You got to call out. And being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Literally, out of his pores in his body, blood was coming out of it, not just sweat. He was in such agony. I think in this moment, it's setting up so much of not just going to the cross, but it was the final stamp, I believe, even in that moment, that he said, "I'm not going to ditch out of this. I'm not going to let my humanity, I'm not going to let my emotions get in the way. I'm going to stick to it because it's not what I want, God. It's what you want, Father." During this time, he's here, sweat like drops of blood. He's agonizing. He's in the pain. The disciples are over here zonked out, straight sleeping. And he was like, he walks over, "Can you guys just wake up, man? Like, pray with me for 1 hour, I ask." He goes back and prays. They zonk out again. There's one disciple in particular missing. His name is Judas Iscariot. And he got with a band of soldiers, his posse, and he brought him in. And he told them ahead of time, "The man whom I kiss on the cheek is the one Jesus who you're supposed to take." So he brings them in. They all kind of set up. It looks like about a shootout's about to go down or something. At one point, like, Peter goes off, cuts a dude's ear off. I mean, it was like, it was action right there. Jesus is like, "Hold up, chill out, I gotta go. Like, this is the plan." Judas shows up, though. He kisses him on the cheek, and, like, I was hearing it. It was sort of weird, but I could just hear. I could hear, like, a kiss on the cheek. The sound of betrayal. Like, literally a kiss, something used traditionally to express some sort of love or thankfulness or gratitude or just something that you do in affection. Here you hear the sound of betrayal setting up the sound of the cross. Jesus is taken in secret in the night. Everything they were doing, it was secretive. It was not set up with how the law was supposed to do things. Brought him before all the different Jews, brought him before this kind of like lead Pharisee. He's before Caiaphas. They're accusing him. They're mocking him. This is what the Bible says in Matthew 26, 27. I hear Matthew saying it. "Then they spit in his face, struck him with their fists. Others slapped him." He's being judged. He's being accused of something he hadn't done. They were bringing people in to give false testimony, to make up a bunch of stuff that he hadn't even done. And he's sitting there. If it says in the book of Isaiah 53, that he's like a lamb before its shearers, man, like a lamb going to slaughter. And he was silent. He kind of just sat there and took it. Now, how many of y'all, somebody like punches you in the face, you're going to stand there and take it? I'd struggle. And he just sat there blow after blow, and he just took it. After this, he's taken before a man named Pilate. Taken before this leader of these Roman people, except the Jews had to go before this government set up. And when you heard me earlier saying, "Crucify him, give us Barabbas," what it's setting up is there was this man named Barabbas. He was a rapist. He was a murderer. He was an absolute criminal. And they're saying, "Crucify him, get rid of this guy, kill him." And he's like, I'm not seeing anything wrong with this dude. Like, Jesus, tell me your story. Guys, it's good. Like, I'm not seeing anything wrong with this Jesus. And they're like, crucify him, crucify him. He's like, okay, I got, what am I going to do, man? I can't kill an innocent man. Like, so he goes, okay, once a year we release a criminal of the people's choosing. So he brings out Barabbas, who's like the dirtiest, nastiest, like worst human being on the face of the earth before the people. It was like a done deal, simple. Here's Jesus, who had done nothing wrong. Here's Barabbas, who was just like a surefire to stay in prison. And he goes, okay, so this is simple. They're going to choose Jesus. I can like wash my hands of this. I can walk away. And he goes, who should I release, Barabbas or Jesus? Their response, give us Barabbas. And they begin to chant it, give us, give us, give us Barabbas. So now a rapist, a murderer is released back in the streets, and Jesus of Nazareth is continued to be taken for his preparation to go to the cross. They kept pushing and pushing even after this, and they're saying, crucify him. And he's like, he's done nothing wrong. So finally, to appease the people, the only thing that he could think to do at this point is like kind of give him a slap on the hand. Like do something that could show the people, okay, I'll like hurt him a little bit. I'll appease you. Then I don't have to kill him and we can move on with this. So he sent him to be whipped. The Bible says to be flogged. And it says in John 19:1-3, then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. Now, traditionally, what they would do is they would take like rods or different things like that, and they would put quite a thrashing. But when you read the encounter that Jesus had in this moment, eventually it says that his bones were bleached by the sun. Well, how does that happen? It was called a cat of nine tails, and it would have hooks and things into it. And when they struck, it wasn't just like a hit. When they struck, it would dig into the flesh, and it'd rip flesh off with it. And I'm going to set it up, because some people might be a little squeezy in this room. I'm going to show you a little clip of Hollywood's version. Still can't even come close to what Jesus had to go through. But when it says flogged, what Pilate's intention was just beat him up a little bit to just show he's a little black and blue, he's a little bit bloody. It wasn't to do what the soldiers decided to do. The soldiers went into over mode. They twisted a crown together. A crown of thorns, they put it on his head, they mocked him. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again saying, Hail, King of the Jews. And they slapped him in the face.
Flagello.
Alcuni clavis, eh?
No, can.
Contra nobis quodibetur.
Prova et tud.
Quale?
Nimes ac parvo.
Didi bene est. Gusta, gusta!
Qui faccio?
Qui pementa la magna.
Bene!
If the cross had ears, I was trying to imagine what would the cross that Jesus died on, what would it have heard? The sound of absolute sin abusing, brutalizing Jesus, absolutely. But what would it have heard? It heard whipping, it heard people cursing, and it heard people beating him. It could hear people spitting on him. You know, we're there in the garden, Judas betrays him, but then Peter, now it said that Jesus had three closest disciples, Peter, James, John. Peter, one of his closest disciples, denied him. Jesus even told him, you're going to do it. It's going to happen. There he is. He's with all the Jews, and they're judging him, and they're falsely accusing him. And here's Peter, one of his closest companions, and he's there off to the side just kind of watching from a distance, and somebody notices, hey, whoa, you're Peter. Like, you're with him. No, I don't know. The sound of betrayal, the sound of complete denial. They finally took the cross, they strapped it on his shoulders, and they marched him to what the Bible says is called Golgotha. Now, Golgotha meant the place of the skull. The mountain sort of looked like a skull where they would crucify people. And they strapped it onto him, and he began to carry it, and even at one point, he couldn't carry it anymore. He was so weak, they had already beat him to a pulp so bad that he couldn't do it. So they grabbed this guy, he was from the crowd, his name's Simon from Cyrene, and threw it on him. And I just started thinking, man, like, here's Jesus and here's Simon. What, did they say anything? Like, Simon's so close, like he can hear Jesus' breath. He can hear his heart probably pumping. He can probably hear the blood dripping down his arm. I mean, he's so close. Like, to be that close, like that close to the Son of God, I'm just imagining what was happening there. I started asking myself, I wonder how many other bodies besides Jesus were placed on this same cross. No one in the Bible was like, hey, they got a brand new cross and just finished putting it together and they put Jesus on it. Like, the purpose of it was to make it as disgusting and agonizing. I'm sure they wanted as many splinters in it and pieces coming out and as many things as possible. I wonder how many other men were on this same cross that Jesus went to, and they cried out in just horror. And if this cross could have ears, I wonder what story it would tell us. Not just of Jesus, but of 3, 10, 50, 100, 500, I don't know, other people that died on this. I find it so interesting, so profound, that the sins of so many men in blood covered this cross, but the salvation of one man's blood forgave the sins, many sins of all these men. This man, Jesus, that went to this cross and shed his blood that covered it, one man covered the sins of many. We don't exactly know the style of the cross and or exactly how they crucified him. There's so much research that you could do. They say possibly it was like a capital T, or what we know as like a lowercase T. They even said other ones kind of looked like almost a tree. The branches would go out and they would just sort of jaggedly reach them. We know it was some sort of fixture that hung up that their body would go on, and many scholars believe obviously this could be it, this sort of look. They would stretch the criminal's arms across it, many times rope around it. They'd pierce into, they even call it like the arm because it wasn't quite the hand or the wrist, sometimes the arm. Now there's accounts, in 1968, they actually uncovered a buried body that had been crucified. They had found actual pierce marks, they found all the indications that it was a Roman crucifixion. Now, typically what they would do is they'd leave a body up on a cross to finally just decay, to the point that there was no reason to bury it. But in some instances, if you find in the account of Jesus, they buried his body because it was on the Sabbath, and you wouldn't leave up something like that on the Sabbath. That was just unholy. You didn't do it in that culture. So they pulled the body down. So there was in some cases where they pulled bodies down because the family wanted the body buried. This body buried, they found indications, they found holes through about right here how he had been hung. Now, we've kind of been taught that always the feet would kind of go in front of the cross, and there is quite a possibility that that's how it hung. But in this account and others that we researched, they would actually strap the ankles to the outside, and they would kind of stretch them out like this, and they would see through the ankles that it would pierce through it. And then actually basically staple them to the outsides of it. Finally, when they wanted them to die, they'd break their kneecaps, and then they would, because they were too tired, they couldn't hold themselves up. You can hear their last breaths. I can just hear. Many times they obviously pierced them, but they would hold the rope up, because one thing you need to understand about a Roman crucifixion, it wasn't to kill someone. There was a lot quicker and easier ways to kill someone. The identity of the cross was to bring the most brutal, the most immoral, the most barbaric, the most horrific torture possible to a human being. That was the intent of the cross. It was to publicly humiliate and ridicule somebody and give them the worst death possible. That's the creation of the cross. So when we hear the sound of the cross, you hear people just screaming bloody murder. When you hear the sound of the cross, if you begin to hear it, you can hear just absolute torture. It's worse than an electric chair. It's worse than just a lethal injection. It's worse than a hanging. It's over a period of time, they would let the person finally just be so tortured, they would die. The intent wasn't to kill them. The intent was to torture them. So this cross, the identity that our Savior had to take on upon this cross, was pure and utter torture. It was ugliness. It was brutality. And what I find so gripping about the gospel, about this God that we serve, for God so loved the world, he so loved us in the worst of our sin, that he gave his only son Jesus to go to that, to endure that, to take on the identity of that we might not perish but have everlasting life. It took the ugliness of the cross to bring the beauty of God. It took the ugliest, most disgusting, most brutal thing on the planet at that time. It took the ugliness of the cross to show the beauty and the love of God. Without this ugliness, we would never know the beauty of God's face. We would never know eternity and the possibility to be with him in heaven. We would never know what it's like. I can hear the hammer just begin to hit the nails, pounding into his feet. I can feel his heartbeat trying to keep up. It's racing. It's slowing down. And many times people would die from heart attacks on the cross. Too much blood pumping in too many places. Lack of breath. His lungs giving way. He's groaning. I can hear it so softly. I can hear his mother Mary in the crowd. I can hear her crying, watching her son. And here Jesus, he's hanging between two criminals, the Bible says, to his left and to his right. The Bible says that the rulers sneered at him, the soldiers, they mocked him, called him King of the Jews. They even placed a sign to mock him. And Jesus lets out this sound. In Luke 23, verse 34, he says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." How many times are you in the midst of something tough, something tragic, something you just don't want to deal with, And your first reaction, your first inclination is, well, they just don't know what they're doing. I should just forgive them. I mean, we're not even talking about crucifixion here. We're talking about petty things we go through. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they were doing. See, it's from the sound of horror, it's from the sound of torture, it's from the sound of absolute hatred, it's from that sound that the sound of hope, the sound of love, and the sound of forgiveness was released. I don't understand God's plan. I don't understand why it took such hatred to fall upon him, but it took the sound of torture to release the sound of forgiveness. It took the sound of hatred to release the sound of love. This is what it took that we might not just endure this life, not just survive in this life, but thrive, be something great, have a hope, a future. And it says in Luke 23, here he is, he's hanging between these criminals. And one of the criminals, still hatred is his heart, the Bible says, who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said. Since you are under the same sentence, we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Here's a broken man taking his last breaths. He knows he deserves his death. He deserves torture. He's a criminal. And yet, you will find that faith can still rise in the midst of forgiveness. You will find that when you receive the forgiveness of Jesus and the love of Jesus, wherever you're at and whatever you're going through, whatever your hardest time is, you will see you have faith to believe for something bigger yet. You'll see that you can still, even in the midst of your last breath, there's still something more. He hears this forgiveness of Jesus. He sees, he hears this love of Jesus. He realizes he's a sinner in need of a Savior. He realizes that he's in need of forgiveness. And when he understood the need for forgiveness, that's when his faith began to kick in to action. That's when he began to call out. When I was a boy, not just a boy, when I was a little bit older, maybe like last year, I've sometimes lived by this phrase that it's better to ask for forgiveness than permission. It's easier. And I realized there's just some dumb things I could just get away with, some things I could do, and I'll just ask for forgiveness later. I think many times when we look at the cross, we can see the identity of forgiveness transpiring. But if you really listen close to the sound of the cross, you'll realize that it's not better to ask for forgiveness than permission. It's a lot better to ask for forgiveness and permission. Jesus didn't die just to forgive you of all the bad stuff you've done. He died to give you permission to live in all the good stuff that he has for you. To be forgiven of this stuff and not have permission to live in the good stuff, it's only a halfway job. The sound of the cross brought the forgiveness and the permission into eternal life. So follow me here. Two thieves, one mocking and rebuking Jesus, the other faith rising in the midst of forgiveness. And Luke 23, 42 and 43 says, this thief, then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus answered him, truly I tell you, today you'll be with me in paradise. Truly I tell you, I know you're hanging there because you've done a lot of stuff wrong. But I not only just give you my permission, I mean my forgiveness, truly I tell you right now, you're going to be with me. I give you permission. You're going to be with me in paradise. I sat in my office all day today. And I'd start to write some of this and I'd just cry. And I'd write some and I'd cry. And I'm like, man, God, what's going on, man? And I just lifted my hands. I was all by myself. And I said, Jesus, forgive my humanity. God, forgive me for not remembering what you had to go through so that I could have the permission to live in life, to have eternal life, to have a blessed life. And then I'd start writing some more of it, and then I'd just stop and I'd cry again. And I'd hear somebody walking by, and I'd wipe my eyes really quick. The sound of the cross, this Jesus, this same Jesus that we sing songs about and we talk about all the time, we forget just how big of a deal it was and what he had to do so that we could do all these other things. And we just take advantage of it and we take it for granted. And what I have to tell you tonight is this. You need to stop living in the same vicious cycle you've been living in and just asking for forgiveness for your sins. And you need to start receiving permission to live a better life. You need to receive the permission on the cross right now. He's saying, you know what? You weren't supposed to be, but I'm not just going to forgive you and send you somewhere like that's crap. I'm going to forgive you, and today you're going to be with me in paradise. You need to start receiving permission to take hold of your future. Permission to walk away from some of your struggles you're in. Permission to start hearing the sound of the cross reign over your circumstances, your past, present, and future. And start hearing the sound that Jesus took in torture so that you could walk in freedom. That Jesus became a slave so you could be free. And we need to start taking hold of this sound. And we got to start walking in this sound. Collision's over. Big events are over. Let's just get to business right now. Let's get to the basics right now. Let's walk in freedom right now. We don't need big songs. We don't need big events. We don't need big moments. We just need a big God who sent his one and only son, Jesus, so we can walk in the freedom and the permission to be people of God. I want you to stand up on your feet right now. And if you're under the sound of my voice, then let me tell you this. Even better, you're under the sound of the cross. Wherever you find yourself, whatever you have going on, it's not a big enough deal to keep you from the cross. You know what's interesting? I've lived for Jesus for 25 years of my life. Anybody in here live for Jesus that long? Just Dave, it's because you're old, man. Right? I've never done drugs. Anybody in here done drugs? Good, some honest people. I've never drank before. Anybody in here drank? I've never cussed. No, just joking. Okay, so I'm not judging you. Let me get to my point here. I have many other things I could list that I've done that we're not going to go there. I'm just making a point. On surface level, it might look like I'm better than some people. On surface level, it might look like I have my life more together than some people. On surface level, it might look like I'm kind of here and some people are here. Do you want me to tell you what happens when you respond to the sound of the cross? See, at the foot of the cross, everybody's on the same level. at the foot of the cross, there isn't, well, you did drugs and you didn't, or you slept with somebody and you didn't, or you stole this and you didn't. It's everybody's human. All have fallen short of the glory of God, and everybody bows down at the feet of the cross. What this is when you respond to the sound of the cross and we all come here, we're all in the same place. There is no somebody above, somebody else. There is no better than somebody. There is no you've done this or not done that. We're all the same. So tonight, under the sound of the cross, we all get to respond the same. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter where you've been. It doesn't matter how you've been struggling maybe today or you've been doing great. It just does not matter, because the cross equalizes us. The cross brings us all to the same place. The cross is all about us coming to Jesus and not about what you have or haven't done. It's needing Jesus. So with your heads bowed and your eyes closed here, I shared in the very beginning, is it possible to know the sound of something you've never heard? Tonight, you've heard the sound of the cross. It is your responsibility to respond. It is your job to lay down whatever you got going on, whatever you're struggling with, whoever you think you want to be and you know you shouldn't. Your identity, your future, everything. It's your job to lay it at the feet of the cross and respond to the sound. So tonight, if you want to take the first step, you want to do that, do it with me across this place. We're going to pray a prayer out loud. It's acknowledging Jesus as God. It's acknowledging the forgiveness of our sins, but more importantly in this moment, to not just simply be forgiven, but to receive permission into the best life. So say it with me. Say, Jesus, thank you for your love. Thank you for the sound of the cross, for your forgiveness. But right now, Jesus, not just forgiveness, not just grace, but now your permission to live in the best life, a life that can be free from sin, from addictions, from any strongholds that want to keep me from you. Tonight, Jesus, I respond to the cross. At the foot of the cross, I'm equal with everybody and anybody, because you died so that I could have a fair shot at the best life and the best eternity. Not because I did everything right to get there, but because you did everything right to get me there. So tonight, Jesus, I receive your forgiveness and your permission to hear the sound that came from the cross. Not just 2,000 years ago, but that same cross, it echoes to my heart today. I receive you, Jesus. I make you Lord, God over my whole life. Jesus, I thank you for every person here. I thank you that they're not just under the sound of my voice, but they're under the sound of the cross in this house. Not just a cross up here as an illustration, a prop, but Lord, the cross, the one that you bled and died on, that we might walk in the passion of Jesus Christ, that we might walk, Lord, through by the Spirit of God that went with Jesus Christ, that we might know the Father that sent this Jesus Christ, and that we might come into relationship through the forgiveness and the permission of this Jesus Christ. God, we give you all the praise for this night. We ask you to continue this work in our heart. We pray this in Jesus' name.